Hey, everybody, and welcome to this episode of Backlog. This is Costume Quest 2, right in just in time for Halloween. I mean, Christmas. Anyway, poorly timed, but it's here. This is going to be kind of a long one. Not because of anything, any reason in particular. Mostly because I was trying to do the first quest in the game, like the real major first quest, and I didn't realize how long the first quest was, and it turns out it's the first area quest, so that didn't work out too well. So we don't actually, we get to the end of the last stage of the quest, but we don't actually finish it, because if we did, it would probably be like a 2 hour long video, and it's already too long as it is, so I didn't do that. The other thing you'll notice here is, if you haven't played the first costume quest, that there's no voice acting. It's all, we all have just little word bubbles, so we don't have to worry about subtitles.
So don't worry about that.
Anyway. Costume Quest, if you don't know already, is an RPG put out by Double Fine, who used to do a ton of awesome games, but in recent history they haven't done too much. Mostly done a lot of really small games. Broken Age, I believe, was the last game that they did. And then they did a Psychonauts VR for the PlayStation VR, which I believe is coming to other platforms, coming to other VR platforms in the future. But this was the last major release as far as like a published by a major publisher and all that good stuff that they did. And it was the sequel to their first game, the first game in the series, obviously, Costume Quest, which the conceit of Costume Quest is that you are a bunch of kids who get together to go out trick-or-treating, and these monsters invade, and when the monsters invade to try to take all your candy, gives you superpowers in the way that your costumes transform into whatever it is that they actually represent. So if you're a superhero, have a superhero costume, you turn into a superhero. If your costume is, you know, a big lobster, you turn into a big lobster, you know. Same type thing. In this game, at least it seems like it, they've kind of toned down or gone back to the drawing board with some of the costumes. They're not quite as cool as they were in the first one, at least the ones that I've seen so far. But they get the job done. They're all right. The conceit in this one, as you're seeing, is this dentist wants to get rid of candy and Halloween and all that good stuff. So there's some kind of monster totem or something that he goes back in time and gets, and for some reason that gives him the ability to get rid of all this stuff, and then he somehow takes over the world. I don't know. I haven't finished the game. That's what's on there so far. That's what's on offer for the first 2 hours of the game, which is all I've played. So, anyway, I have not touched this game. As tradition in Backlog, I have not played it at all. So, whereas it is a series that I've played, it is not the actual game I have not touched. And I know I did promise everybody that I wouldn't just be doing backlog videos for the next while, and all I've done is backlog videos. So sorry about that. This will be actually the last one for quite a while, because there's a lot of stuff coming. So this just happened to be it just happened to work out time wise and everything else. And I had to do a whole bunch of, I wanted to get a whole bunch of content ready for you guys. So, in doing that, it turned out that one of the easy ways to do it was to do another backlog video. But pretty soon, you're going to have Game of the Year content coming up. So you're going to have a lot of videos for that. As I said before, I am doing, my top five, games of the year in video form. And then the other five that make up the top 10 game video games of the year. The other five will be articles on the Hades Times website. So you're going to have 5 through 10 as articles. Actually, 6 through 10 as articles. And then 1 through 5 as videos. So, and as it turns out so far, they're not short videos. So strap in. And basically what we're going to do in those videos is just talk about what makes the videos Game of the Year worthy and why I picked them and all that good stuff. So it's going to be kind of, it's going to be a little free form, but I'm actually, you know, there are actually things that I do want to cover. So trying to make the videos as good as I possibly can, as long as, you know, give me enough time to work, you know, to work everything in. And make sure that everything's good. So, you know, there we go. As far as this game's concerned, I am a really big fan of Costume Quest. I really enjoyed Costume Quest a lot. It was a game I played when it first came out, and it kind of freaked me out. It freaked me out in the sense that I wasn't really expecting too much. I thought it was just going to be kind of like it's all right. But it turned out to be such a good game that I was really excited about it, and I ended up finishing it. I even kind of considered playing it a second time after I had finished playing it the first time. And a game like this, you know, there's not a whole lot you can do after you play through it the first time that would make that much of a difference. I mean, there's some secrets you can find and things like that, but nothing major. See, so here's the costume thing. I think that anybody who hasn't seen this before, this is gonna blow their frickin' mind. At least it did me when it happened the first time. They have kind of streamlined the system a little bit. It's always been timing based. Like it is in this game. So it's a lot like a lot of the other modern totally lost what I was gonna say. What the name of it is. The turn-based. Yes, that's it. There we go. A lot of the other turn-based role-playing games that have come out in the last, oh god, what is it, 4 or 5 years? Probably a little more than that. This is the Xbox One version of Costume Quest 2, so I just want to make that clear, that this is not a last-generation game. Even though it is on backlog, which we've been doing a lot of last-generation stuff, but actually, this is a current gen game. We're not doing a backwards compatible thing here. The first game was on the old generation systems because it came out quite a while ago. When this game came out, I was really exciting, but the reviews for it were not that great because a lot of people had expectations based on the last game, and this game is about the same as the last game as far as systems and mechanics and difficulty and everything else, people just didn't take to it quite the way that they did at the first one, even though the games were very, very similar. And it should have been a pretty slam dunk, considering the games were pretty far apart as far as you know, people getting sick of that kind of game or something like that. Maybe it was that South Park Stick of Truth had come out around the same time. I believe that's true. I'm not sure, though. That could be, or, you know, they also had that Penny Arcade series that had pretty much the same mechanics as well. Maybe the mechanics just had, you know, people were done with the mechanics. I definitely would have liked to hear some voice acting in this game. And I think that's probably a bridge too far. I mean, I think the budget that they use for these games is super, super small. So I don't think that... I think voice acting is probably too much to ask. So, you only see one character transform. The character that you are playing as in the... the character that you are is the character that you see transform. So whatever costume you switch that character to is the costume that you're going to see in the little cinematic bit there. Just so that's clear. And you only play as the one character, Reginald. You don't play as all of them. They're in your party, and you control them in battle. But that's it. Much like, as I said, a lot of other modern turn-based strategy games that have come out. I will say, though, that the one of the complexities of this game is that the timing for everybody's attacks are different. So when you get three characters in battle... that each one of their attack timings will be different. So that is something that adds complexity to the game. And obviously you want to get amazings if you possibly can, which means you have to time it where that circle is at the very lowest, right before you would lose it. In other words, right before you would get a whoops. So that's a challenge. I do like the candy corn flavor text. I think it's kind of cool. It does get a little old after a while, but you do, you are eventually able to switch out of candy corn so that you don't have to, so that you're not down a person, because you're effectively down a person with candy corn. The taunt on candy corn, is so small that, it doesn't do much good. The other thing with this game that I thought was interesting and, maybe a reason why people didn't enjoy it as much is because it's very easy. The major challenge with the game is to find all the secrets. Some of the secrets are not secrets, they're things to move the story along. So it's kind of difficult sometimes to tell what is a optional thing and what is a, necessary thing. In fact, I would even argue that, there aren't really any optional quests in the game. Because of the way levels work and the way that some of the stuff works in the game, it just doesn't seem to me like there are really any optional quests or optional areas. Looking at this now, though, I see an area where I can go back to later, so maybe there is a little bit of optional stuff here. Anyway, I won't be playing this game again for a long time, so I'll probably forget all that by then. I will play this again. I did enjoy playing it. I do like costume quests an awful lot. It's not that. That's not the reason why. It's going to be a long time. It's because I just don't have time. I have a ton of stuff to do, and I have a ton of games to go through. And I found out recently that some of the games that I sort of was like, oh, you know, I'm not maybe going to do those. I'm not going to cover that stuff. I decided against that, and I'm going to cover it. So I'm going to be doing double duty on videos probably through the holiday season. So you're going to get a lot of videos from me during a time when most people don't do videos at all or do very few. So hopefully you will enjoy that. I know if I was a viewer, I would enjoy it. So, I mean, that's part of the reason why I schedule the way I do. I try to think of what I would want if I was a viewer, if I was a subscriber to the channel, you know, what I would want. So that's how I look at it. I hope that that's the way everybody who does YouTube videos does it. I know that it's probably not, but I hope that ends up being something that people think about, because as we go forward, you know, doing this kind of stuff as a medium, I think that we have to keep that kind of thing in mind. I think there was definitely a time when it didn't matter so much. In fact, there was probably a time when it didn't matter at all. But I think that now, you know, with YouTube Red and all these other, you know, all the other things that streaming video offers, I mean, you know, Twitch and YouTube and the services that are out there now, and how important it is for the video game industry, and how important it is for, you know, people's happiness. You know, I've heard a lot of people on a lot of my favorite YouTube channels, you know, they'll donate and they'll tell the person, you know, while they're streaming, they'll donate and they'll say that, you know, this is for all the times you got me through a hard time. You know, I love, you know, your positivity. You know, you're really great. You really helped me out, you know, when I was going through some stuff. And I think that's really important. And I think that everybody who is a participant in what we do is, you know, in that same boat. We're all kind of not responsible, but that's kind of the wrong word, but I think that that's kind of what it is. We're responsible to, you know, help people out in that way. This is where you get that main quest. It's the main story quest, and it turns out to be the main area quest. It doesn't seem like it, but that is what it is. You used to get these in the Costume Quest 1. You would get them, and they wouldn't generally be difficult. They would just be like something you would be doing anyway, which is kind of the way I viewed this. But as it turns out, the requirement for this quest, and I didn't read it, which maybe that was the wrong thing to do. I should have read it, probably, because it doesn't say it in the text, obviously, that you're, you know, that you're getting. But I probably should have read it, because basically what it is, you have to do all the houses in the level. And I didn't realize that, but I thought I had done all the houses in the level until I got the map that showed I did not. So, it was a smart thing to do on the developer's part, because that way you can use any of the candy that you get, and you don't have to worry about, giving the candy to all, you know, giving this candy to the Skull Kid. But by the same token, because it doesn't explain it, it's a little bit more difficult to figure out. So now we have the clown. The clown's really cool in some ways. He does some decent damage. Not as much damage as a superhero dude, but some decent damage. But his big thing is that he can heal. And in combat, it's pretty difficult to heal. So it's great that they give you that. However, his timing is totally different than the superhero, and you end up making a lot of mistakes. Well, at least I ended up making a lot of mistakes doing that. And I'll have to—I will say that you see me using the ultimate attacks quite. You'll see me using them quite liberally, The reason for that is that you need to use them kind of as soon as you have an opportunity to use them, because when you're not using them, you're not gaining not gaining bar to use them again. And it's going to be, you know, that's a bad thing. So even if you kind of waste it, so to speak, I mean, I try not to do that, but even if you sort of waste it, you're still better off, because then you're gaining bar towards the next one, and you're always gaining. So it's not like, oh, well, you know, how am I going to build this up? You know, I'm going to fight, you know, so many guys to fill this up again if I do that. No, it doesn't work like that. It really, you're always gaining bar, so there's no point in saving it. So that's pretty cool. I enjoyed it. I enjoy this game a lot, I have to say. That's one of the reasons why I played it for so long in this play session, other than the fact that I was trying to get through that quest, and I thought that, okay, well, it can't be much longer. Boy, was I wrong. So, anyway, the secrets in the old games used to be like special costumes, like secret costumes. You'd always know that it was a secret costume because you didn't need to have it to get into another area. And there weren't that many of them in the last game. I think there were just like two or three. So there is a lot of grinding in this game. A lot. You're grinding fights. You're grinding candy. You're kind of constantly searching around, which is interesting. It's an interesting mechanic. It's not interesting searching around. Not necessarily, anyway. So, yeah, you're just... It's just such a different thing than... At least I'm used to, at least lately. I've been playing so many, you know, action-y games where, you know, everything is about, you know, getting headshots and stuff, that this sort of thing was... a nice breath of fresh air. It was just different, which was in that way, it was really great. And maybe that's why I played it so much. But I did actually get a little addicted to another game that I was going to originally do just for something to have on the channel, you know, something to kind of give you folks kind of an idea of the kind of stuff that I'm really into. And it's the backwards compatible version of SSX, and I kind of lost my stuff on that game. I'm gonna play a lot more of SSX. I played it for the video. I probably will do more SSX videos. You should be looking for an SSX video pretty shortly here in the future. I'll talk more about it in the video, but yeah, man, I forgot how much I love that game. I played a lot of that game when it came out. It was one of my favorite games, but I guess I just had the disc. Because it didn't come up in my Xbox, you know, when they show up old games that you purchase digitally. I bought a lot of disc games back then, and I didn't realize how many disc games I actually purchased, because man, I don't have very many many digital games from back in the day. I really thought I had more, and it's amazing how many I don't have. Which really sucks, because I don't, you know, it's one of those things, I don't know how much time I will devote to an old game like that. So, like, to buy Fable, or to buy, like, Oblivion or something like that, it just seems stupid. I mean, I have those games on the PC, but the problem is that... you know, my computer doesn't run all that great. I guess when I get a new computer, it won't be an issue anymore. But, you know, just to have it in the short term, you know. Something that you are pretty sure you already purchased, you know, to have again. It would be really nice. But apparently I don't really have too many. I know I bought a lot of digital games on the PS3. But that obviously doesn't help me. It would be nice if Sony figured out a way to do backwards compatibility on the PlayStation 4 rather than trying to sell us PlayStation Now, which nobody wants. I don't think anybody wants it. Anyway, I did want to address something that I've been thinking about lately, especially in this game, which is so much grinding. I mean, how many times can you see this, see these battle mechanics over and over again? What I will mention, though, is that I did use a card called Ghost Munch, and what that does is it hurts. Every time an enemy attacks you, they do damage to themselves. So even if you block, they will do damage to themselves. It's not a lot of damage, and it's not every time. It's they have a chance of doing damage to themselves. I thought it was every time. I also didn't realize that it was persistent. There is a definitely over a course of turns, you are able to continue to have that. I believe when I try to activate another card, you will see how many turns it actually is active for. I think it's 5 turns. Not 5 turns, but 5 battles. Sorry, 5 battles, I believe it is. Anyway, what I wanted to address real quick was just something that I kind of noticed. It was just a kind of a trend that I noticed in my videos of late, and something that I don't know that everybody realizes or understands, and maybe... You know, there's a kind of a skewed viewpoint that is getting around. And what that is that I don't play games on the Xbox One mostly because I really like Microsoft or Xbox or... You know, I have a reason to only play games on that platform. In fact, it's kind of the opposite. Normally, games run much worse on the Xbox than they do on the PlayStation. The PlayStation is definitely my preferred platform. If I go out and buy a game that is multi-platform, like Battlefield 1 or Titanfall 2 or For Honor... or any of those games. If I go out and purchase any of those games, I would purchase them on the PlayStation 4 because they run better. They have... most of my friends are on the PlayStation 4. I have very few friends on the Xbox. Most of my friends from the Xbox were from the 360 days, and a lot of those people don't play anymore. Or if they do play, they don't play games that I play. Or they play multi-platform games on the Xbox One, for whatever reason. So, you know, like, for instance, I have a lot of friends that play Smite, and a lot of friends that play Call of Duty, and a lot of friends that play Destiny. All those people play on the Xbox, because they had the Xbox 360 and they didn't do any research or whatever, and they just bought, you know, the Xbox One. So I do have people that I play with like Destiny and stuff like that on the PS4, but it's a lot more people. So I ended up purchasing everything on the PS4. Similarly, like with Overwatch, I purchased it on the PlayStation 4 because I knew more people were going to purchase it on the PlayStation 4 than it would be on the Xbox, because there are more PlayStation 4s than there are Xboxes. At least there used to be. Now it's kind of catching up. And I think it's really funny because everybody's making such a big deal out of, like, you know, Xbox is outselling PlayStation. It's like, well, that's because all the PlayStations have, you know, everybody who wants a PlayStation purchased one already. You know, so now everybody's buying their second console. So it's not, you know, there are just so many people out there who want to purchase a game console. It's not like, you know, it's a never-ending, you know, it's a never-ending pool. It's really funny because, you know, last year, you know, for the PlayStation 4 launch, they had a record launch. They had a record first year, and I believe they even had a record second year. So it's not like, you know, it's not like they're doing badly or anything. But anyway, I mean, good for Microsoft. Hopefully they sell a lot of Xbox One S's so that the price goes down, because I want one, and I don't want to pay a lot for it. And also, I don't have any 4K anything yet, so I also don't really need one. But by the time I do, I hope that the prices are way down, because I won't have a lot of money by that point, because I will have bought all kinds of other stuff that I need. So anyway, so I just wanted to clear up the fact that, you know, I played Dishonor on the Xbox because it was a Bethesda game. I figured that the graphics might be a little better. As it turned out, they weren't. As it turned out, I believe that it's still running. I believe that the Xbox One version of Dishonored 2 runs at 900p rather than 1080p. So we missed on that. We missed on that one. But playing through a bunch of Dishonored, I've played about 4 hours of Dishonored now. And I have a video going up for that soon. It's a long video, and I haven't been able to edit it properly yet. So that's another reason why that hasn't gone up yet. So with that, the way that video turned out, it seems to me like Dishonored 2 is definitely a game that I need a lot of time to get through, a lot of patience. And I'm going to probably pick it up on the PC when I get a new PC and not worry about any of this frame rates stuff. See, it says battles left. So I think each card does 3 to 5 battles, I believe. So anyway, yeah, it's going to be something I'm going to pick up on the PC and not worry about this, you know, frame rates and all this other stuff. Supposedly it's not been optimized quite well enough for the PC quite yet, but by the time I pick it up, I'm sure it will. By the time I pick it up, it'll have lots of patches. And if it doesn't, I'm sure somebody will mod some stuff into it that'll fix it by then, because it's a long time. These pink guys will poison you, so it's a good idea to get rid of them as soon as possible. I don't know that I did that in this battle. I might not have. I just figured I'd get rid of them quick enough that it wouldn't matter, but then they started focusing on me, and I'm like, this isn't good. So anyway, so the big thing is that I just wanted to make clear that, you know, I'm not an Xbox fanboy. I'm definitely, if nothing else, I'm a PC fanboy, which probably is a bad thing, considering I don't have a decent PC. for a long time, I was a Sony fanboy, but I think that they kind of messed up with the PlayStation 4. They didn't make it powerful enough, and I think both companies really screwed up this generation. They didn't make their consoles powerful enough, and now they're playing this backtracking game with, you know, the PS4 Pro and then the Scorpio, and I just think that was all just such a big mistake. The PS4 Pro and the Scorpio should have been the consoles that came out in 2014, and not what came out, because they were nowhere near powerful enough to be, you know, have any parity in the market whatsoever. So, you know, that just is stupid. Anyway, so I think that I'm recording this the day of the Game Awards, which is December 1st. And I think a lot of people, there's a certain percentage of people, I think, that really love the Game Awards, and think that they are, they're done really well, and that they're fun, and everything else. And then there's the other percentage of people who just thinks that they should just come out with a bunch of trailers and be done with it. I've always kind of been of two minds about the Game Awards. I love Jeff Keighley. I think he's great. I think he's, I think he does a really, he does a lot of work. And I think he puts a lot of himself out there to do this event. And since it's no longer being done by Game Trailers, and then it stopped being done by Spike, I think he really took a lot of control. You know, he had to take a lot of control, and what he's done has been really, really good. But by the same token, the idea of a video game award show is just kind of silly. And while I like some of the things about it, I especially like the trailers. I mean, the trailers, of course, are wonderful and always a fun surprise, no matter what it is. But the actual award show is always kind of flat to me, and has been for quite a while. But, you know, I just kind of wonder, like, with a lot of things nowadays with video games, who are these things marketed for? Because, like, especially some of the nominations, the People's Choice nominations, I mean, there's a lot of, like, League of Legends and Counter-Strike Go and that kind of thing. A lot of people who are really into those games are only into those games. I'm not going to say all. I'm going to say a lot of. Like, a good percentage. Like, people who would care about, you know, a particular player or a particular team on the pro level would probably not be that much into any other games. You know, at least any other mainstream games. So, including, you know, it's kind of a weird thing. I think esports in itself is kind of a weird animal. I've always kind of flirted with covering esports. I've been doing the Hades Times for about 4 years, actually 5 years now, and especially when I relaunched to, you know, with all this video and everything else, I kind of had this pie-in-the-sky idea that maybe I would start covering some esports, covering Overwatch or Heroes of the Storm. I was thinking at least Overwatch, because Heroes of the Storm can get kind of complicated, because they keep kind of changing up the way that leagues are done, and, you know, kind of changing up some of the things that, you know, make it easier, difficult for somebody to follow. And I just didn't want to go through all that, you know, explaining everything and everything else. There are people who are actually paid to do that, so I didn't want to compete with them. So I kind of dropped the idea after a while, especially once I kind of got in touch with how much of a workload video content is to do and have a productive website at the same time, which I don't have yet. So you can see where I wouldn't be able to do more than I'm doing because I can't get done what I'm doing. So it's a little devil goes down to Georgia callback, which I think is pretty funny. They get a lot of mileage out of this clown horn, I have to say. So it's just a weird thing. I think the whole thing is a weird thing. I think as a community, as a video game playing community, as gamers, for lack of a better word, I think we're in a really weird place, and I think we have been in a weird place for a while, but maybe just like a different weird place. Like we started out in the lobby of the weird place, and now we've kind of moved on into the central area of the weird place, and now we're kind of deciding, kind of at starts and stops, what we're going to end up doing, how we're going to end up wanting to view, what's important to us, what isn't, what kinds of things, what types of content we're interested in, that kind of stuff. And of course, as with any other internet thing, there are a lot of strange starts and stops and hiccups and, people who, you don't know, people who don't know what side of the fence that they come down on, and, people who don't even know the fence is there, and, all that kind of stuff. And a lot of, just odd things, that happen and that our evaluation of those things or our interpretation of those things is going to be different all across the board. And for that, I think that we have to give it all more time. I think that that's part of it. But by the same token, I think that stuff like the Game Awards is interesting because it kind of, quote unquote, tries to bring everybody together. And a lot of times that seems strange, that seems odd, that has a certain amount of awkwardness associated with it. And I think that that's maybe what I'm feeling when I watch it, is that awkwardness. If you guys want to tell me in the comments what you think about the Game Awards, that would be awesome, because I often, I ask people I know, and most of the people that I know either don't watch it or they just watch, the trailers. Like, they'll wait until the trailers are up on YouTube and they just watch the trailers. They don't bother watching the show. So, they really don't have an opinion about it. So if you do, let me know. I would really love to know how many of you folks watch this whole video. Let me know. I really want to know, because there's a certain I believe that there is a certain dedication involved in watching I think it's almost an hour long Halloween themed turn-based RPG in December. So let me know. Let me know what's going on. I really want to know. Because you guys are fans, like big fans. or you're just troopers, or you're just kind of weird. And if you're kind of weird, that's you're my people. So good on that. But anyway. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff coming up on this on the channel, on the video, on the Hades Times YouTube channel. There's a lot of stuff coming up. And again, as I promised before, this was not an empty promise. As I promised before, as soon as I get my hands on Dead Rising 4, we will start the Dead Rising 4 campaign. Probably minus the Christmas music, because I don't want to get copyright claimed on Christmas music. Because God only knows what kind of copyright quagmire that Christmas music is in. I don't even want to know. I'm scared. So anyway. The reason I made this commitment about the Dead Rising 4 thing is because I have seen quite a bit of the game. I've seen about an hour of the game, so I'm willing to make that commitment without having it, without having the game, and without having played, you know, actually played any of it. Unless the controls are absolute garbage, then I will let you know that, and we will all be very sad because we won't be playing it. Before that, though, we're gonna have a ton of videos coming up. Before that. So, don't worry about that at all. I know that we're kind of looking at down the barrel of a week, where, I don't necessarily have anything new. But what we're going to do with that is, again, like I said, as soon as I get steep, I'll start putting some videos up for that, but before that, it's just going to be all kinds of weird, random stuff. Try not to do any more backlog videos, I promise. but if worse comes to worse, we might have to do one more. Just one more, but we might have to. Depends on the mail. Actually, we really probably shouldn't have to, because as it turns out, I have Watch Dogs 2 coming, and I should be receiving that this week, so I should be able to put up some gameplay for that between now and time I get steep. So that should work out. And of course, you'll be getting a nice long Dishonored 2 video. That's going to be coming up shortly. It's at the beginning of the game, so really aren't any spoilers, and I'm pretty much just doing side stuff, because the main mission, it seems a little hard. It seems like, maybe take some time to get into that. To me, Dishonored seems like, a little bit difficult, a little bit hard, harder than the first one. AI is definitely tuned a lot differently than the first one. So, and not for the better. You know. But, hey, that is not going to be a problem, because this is just, it's just going to be funning around in Dishonored 2. So don't worry about it. Try not to have any spoilers. You know, maybe teach you a thing or two about how to deal with some situations. Or maybe you, in the comments, can teach me how to deal with these some other situations. You can explain what I'm doing wrong, and that would be great, because I am terrible at that game, and I'm happy to get good at it. I'm happy to get better, but it's going to take me a really long time to get better. So rather than putting everything else on hold for me to get better, I am actually going to just put the game on hold and wait it out. Now we're in the town, and it was really funny, because the way that the Skull Kid kind of implied was that once you got to town, you know, that was going to be it, and you wouldn't have to do any more candy collection. But that is not the case at all. It is not. What it has to be is you have to do all the houses on this level. That is the actual quest goal, which I think could have been made much more clear. In fact, it could have been stated, which it was not. Anyway, so yeah. So don't worry, content's coming. I know that everything has kind of been on delay and everything else, and oh god, I had so many technical problems this last 2 or 3 days getting stuff in the right place to get everything ready to go, and you know, game capture was just one problem after another. So unfortunately, that played into all this. Also, I was kind of trying to front load all my game capture so that I could just do one audio commentary after another, and I didn't have to worry about you know, doing audio commentary and then more game capture and then more audio commentary. And this way I'm just going to do one audio commentary after another, which, believe it or not, is actually a little faster than doing it the other way. I don't know if it's just psychological that it's faster, you know, like I just think it's faster, or it actually is. I don't know, but it seems faster. So that's what definitely we're going to do. That was my point in doing it anyway. So that's why I did it that way, and that was partly why it took so long, because I was having so much trouble with the game capture. But now everything's fine. Game capture's all fixed. Everything's working out just fine. So should be good. Should be all systems go. Shouldn't be a problem. But yeah, so it's been kind of one thing after another, and definitely been trying my best to get some stuff up for you guys so that you don't have a big break in content, even though there kind of has been multiple breaks throughout the last month. The month of November has been definitely my worst month as far as getting content up and getting everything together, and that's, you know, technical problems and illness and all this other stuff. So December will be a lot better. I am 99.9% sure that, barring any unforeseen circumstances, which, God, there better not be any unforeseen circumstances, December should be a hell of a lot better. You're going to get a hell of a lot more content, and especially with the Game of the Year stuff. Most of the Game of the Year stuff, is half done. So, just so you know, so it's not that, so I'm just waiting for the appropriate time to put it up, and kind of a break in my timeline to be able to finish it up, which is, it's coming very soon. So, as soon as I get this run of videos done and up, before I start on Steep, before I start on Dead Rising 4, any of that stuff, before I do any of those things, I will finish off the Game of the Year videos, and I will start putting up the written Game of the Year content on the Hades Times website very soon. It should be sometime in the next week or two. So as far as how often that stuff's going to go up, I'm not really sure yet. Mostly it's going to be based on how many other videos I'm doing at the time, because I don't want to put up too much stuff at once, because if you put up too much stuff at once, everybody just ignores it. You know, like they'll see the first thing, they're like, oh, that's cool, you know, maybe I'll check that out, and then something comes up, you know, 3 or 4 hours later, and they're like, yeah, whatever, you know. So I try not to put up too much stuff at once, because you know, people don't have time to watch it, and it just gets lost in the shuffle. It's amazing to me how different my viewing habits are versus other people, but I also don't have broadcast television, So that plays a part in it too, I guess. YouTube is kind of my major source of, you know, video entertainment. So I can see where, you know, maybe my habits are a lot different than people who, you know, have television and cable and, you know, all that stuff. Because recently I had PlayStation View for a while. And let me tell you, PlayStation View is great. I think that anybody, if you know, if you don't want to have cable and you don't want to, you know, basically is you don't want to have a contract. I mean, that's basically what it is, right? I mean, PlayStation View is not cheap. So it's not a cheaper alternative to having cable. You know, so anybody who says anything about, you know, cutting the cord and all this other garbage and being like, oh yeah, you know, it's a really good deal. No. That's a line of bolt. No. The cheapest option is to get cable or satellite. I don't care where you live. I don't care what situation you're under. The cheapest option is to get cable or satellite. Okay? If nothing else, wait for one of those sales where, like, they lock you in for, like, a year or something. And you're paying, like, nothing. You know, you're paying, like, $30 for 160 channels or something, you know, okay? So, that's not it. What it is that people want, like, Sling or PlayStation View or stuff like that for is they don't want to have a contract. Because they have to pay that all year round. Whether they're home or they're not, whether they watch it or they don't, you know. I made the decision not to have it because it was just on all the time. You know, like, I would have the television on all the time. And it would be very distracting. And I had a lot of stuff that I have to do, you know, like, over the course of the day, you know, I want to get stuff done, and in order to get stuff done, I have to be, you know, be able to concentrate on it and everything else. So to have it on all the time is very distracting, and it's very expensive to have something like that that you're not watching very much on it, but it's just on, you know. So I decided that it was not worth the money to have it. But then, like, you know, here and there, like, I'll come into a situation where I kind of feel like I'm missing out because I have a hard time watching things. You know, I can't watch things when they're on. I have to watch it at the very earliest, the day after. And a lot of stuff I end up having to watch, much later, you know, like on Netflix or, on DVD or Blu-ray. So, it's the timing of it, you know, because you feel kind of out of the conversation, and, you know, you kind of feel like you don't know what's going on when people talk about different television shows or whatever. I'm not usually a person that cares about that kind of stuff, but, you know, every once in a while, if it's a really good show and I've been, you know, kind of interested in it to begin with, you know, I'm kind of ticked off that that works out like that. So at one point, I tried the free trial of PlayStation View. I believe it was last year. And it's a really, really good service. It's very expensive for what you get, but it's a very good service because A, you don't have to have a contract, and B, you don't have to have, you know, there's no installation. As long as you have a PlayStation, you know, and an internet connection, obviously, and PlayStation, I believe you'd still have to have PlayStation Plus, but I'm not sure. You can use it. So there's not installation, which is really nice. It's a really good service, and I have to say that, like, having, my point in all this was having television that was, like, on again all the time, because you can watch live television on PlayStation View, was very distracting, and I didn't watch as much other stuff because I was watching PlayStation View. So I can only imagine people who have regular TV, you know, they probably don't watch as much YouTube as I do, or even nearly as much as I do, because they're watching television, you know. And I don't fault them for that, but so when I say that I'm doing, you know, I'm doing content based on, you know, what I would want, I'm definitely pushing it a lot farther than I would maybe have to. And in some cases, I would be doing a detriment to myself, having, you know, if I started to put up two or three videos a day, because the average person wouldn't even notice, and then it wouldn't be coming up in their subscription list, because all you see in your subscription list is that stuff for that day. So, you know, it wouldn't really work out for me or for them. So as much as I would like to do that, as much as I would like to just take all my Game of the Year content and wait until December 30th and just dump it all out there and everybody could just watch it then, that would be a detriment to both me and you guys, because, you know, you wouldn't notice it as much as if I, you know, strung it out over a course of period of time. So basically what I'm saying is that I'm trying my perfect scenario here is to have one video come out every single day, every week from now on. That's my goal. Whether I reach that goal or not remains to be seen. But that's definitely what I'm shooting for. That's my, that's where we're going with all this. So hopefully that works out. This is a side quest, but as far as I know, this, you have to go into Mink's place and you have to get, music cred. It seems like a side quest. It really does. But every single quest in this game so far has had a kind of an air of side quest about it, except for the quest you're doing for the skeleton kid. Otherwise, all the other quests have seemed like side quests. So I'm guessing that this music cred quest isn't a side quest either. I guess. I don't know. Anyway, I thought because, you know, I could use the horn, it would be musical and da-da-da-da, but anyway. I did do some editing in this video, in the interest of time stuff, even though you're not going to really notice it that much, I don't think. It is definitely there, so I did play this game for a very long time. I believe I played it for about 2 hours. So, I did not intend to do that when I started it. I intended to play for about, between a half hour and 45 minutes. But, because I got this quest, I thought, I'll be able to finish it. So I just decided, I'll just keep going. And it turned out that, like, it just kept going. Literally, like, it was just like, oh my god, why did I do this? But, anyway. So, yeah, it's crazy. But, you guys heard about all the delays that have been started to come out, that just some weird delays, like Hellblade from Ninja Theory, you know, their last Ninja Theory's last game was the DMC game, the Devil May Cry reboot, which I loved. I know a lot of people absolutely did not like it, and there's some people who were kind of lukewarm on it. But their game looks, this new one, it seems very graphically complicated. Like, they're trying to, they're trying to, communicate to the audience, you know, characters' feelings through facial expressions and things like that. And I mean, that's tough. In films and television, it's hard to do that sometimes. So doing that in a video game can be really hard. So they're taking some extra time. They said that they want to, you know, clean up. They had some technical issues, I guess, with the Unreal Engine 4 to begin with. So now they want to make sure that everything works out and everything's good before they put out the game. I think that they're a little... I think that some developers and publishers are getting a little gun-shy with this new... with the current-gen consoles. With some of the problems that have cropped up over the last 3 to 6 months, you know, just some of the things that should have been fixed in QA or whatever weren't, and you know, just various things, you know, the No Man's Sky effect, for lack of a better word, for lack of a better example. So yeah, that got delayed. You know, South Park got delayed a lot. I believe Persona 4 got delayed again. I think it only got delayed like 3 weeks or a month, but that's still like... Persona 5, we've been waiting for that game. I think I looked it up at one point when the delay was announced. And I think we've been waiting for that game for 5 years? What? I think it's either been 5 years or 6 years. It was a long time. Not as long as Final Fantasy 15, but it's still a long time. so that was kind of nuts. The other thing that I heard was that there's a possibility that there's going to be a new Marvel vs. Capcom coming out. And the current rumors as of December 1st, which I guess maybe all of this is going to get put aside on December 2nd, because it's supposed to be, if the rumors are true, it's going to be at PlayStation Experience on December 2nd. So this will, you know, it'll take care of the whole thing. You know, rumors won't be rumors anymore by then. So that's just a day away. So that's pretty cool. But apparently, it's either going to be Marvel vs. Capcom 4, or it's going to be a reboot of the entire thing. Which, considering it's been so long, and considering they can't use the X-Men characters, they probably should just reboot the entire thing. Because at this point, you know, if you're in a Marvel vs. Capcom 4, I think a lot of people are going to expect most of the characters to come back. So, when you're not going to be having, you know, Fantastic Four, you're not going to be having X-Men, you know, that kind of thing, that's going to kind of change, you know, you have to change your expectations. But then again, you know, it's been so long since we had one of those games that maybe it doesn't really matter anymore. I don't know. It doesn't matter so much to me, but I am not... I really loved that game. I'll just say that. I really loved Marvel vs. Capcom 3. It was one of my favorite games. But... It was not supported properly, in my opinion. To such a degree. I mean, Capcom screwed up so much with the support for that game that I think that they, even while everything legally, as far as contracts and everything else and rights and, you know, whatever, you know, all the stuff that, you know, when Disney bought out Marvel, you know, everything changed. But even before that game really wasn't in a good position, and they just did not seem to be taking that seriously. They were so involved in Street Fighter 4 that they just let everything else go on the wayside, by the wayside. And yeah, I mean, sales-wise, Street Fighter 4 definitely was you know, there was a good reason for them to pay a lot of attention to Street Fighter 4. I mean, Street Fighter 4, probably the best-selling fighting game, you know, at the time ever, you know. So I can understand, you know, why they would be so focused on Street Fighter 4. But the thing is that the people, there was such a hardcore fan base around Marvel that I think it's really funny that there's a hardcore fan base around Street Fighter 5, which is like practically the only fan base the game has now. And now they want to bring back, you know, there's the possibility of them bringing back Marvel versus Capcom to try to make it, you know, to a broad audience, because that's what Marvel wants. They want a nice broad audience for all their games, but they don't want the mobile phone audience because they don't have, there's a not enough, the audience doesn't stick enough. It does, you know, because the mobile phone market is so fickle, your audience does not stick unless you're like Candy Crush or Pokemon Go or something. So it's a lot more, you know, the audience is a lot more about novelty than it is about fandom. And I think that's why they want the console market, because the console market is more about fandom and less about novelty, i.e., you know, virtual reality, 3D TVs, the Wii, you know. So yeah, I think that's probably part of it. But I think it's very funny. I mean, Capcom is the story of Capcom a lot of times is based on comes down to things that the fans understand really, really well. And that it seems like the game developer who, you know, they do play the game, you know, should understand it as well, if not better, but it just doesn't seem like they do. Whether they do or not, I don't know, because a lot of times the message, especially when you talk about a Japanese company, sometimes the message gets lost in translation. Sometimes they're not allowed to talk about different things because it, you know, it's not proper to do so. You know, all that stuff is understandable. So it's possible that they do understand, that they just are being kept from discussing it, or there's some financial reasons why they can't do it the way they're supposed to. It's funny because a lot of stuff has come out recently about Street Fighter V and how disappointed the developers are in not only its performance, but in what they were able to put out for it, whereas what they were, you know, what their goals were to put out for it. This is the last house for the quest for the level, so that's why there was that big, huge cut that we warped to someplace else on the map. Because I was like, oh, okay. So yeah, I didn't show you me discovering that on the map and all that other stuff. I just warped over. The pterodactyl is so far the coolest costume in the game so far. It is very cool. You'll see why. I believe. Yeah, I think, yeah, you'll see why. Normally, when a fighting game comes out in a year, it always makes my top 10 list, because I love fighting games. I mean, I'm a big fighting game fan. I'm a big fan of the community. I'm a big fan of games. I mean, I am waiting for Injustice 2 and Tekken 7 with big breath. Especially Tekken 7. I love Tekken. I'm a Tekken man. I've played all the Tekkens from 1 to the last Tag Team Tournament 2. I played them all. I was there at the beginning. I'm going to be there forever. I love Tekken. It's one of my favorite fighting game series of all time. So I'm very excited about that. I was excited about King of Fighters this year. I was excited about Street Fighter this year. I was especially excited about Street Fighter when I found out the jury was going to be in there. And the jury was going to be back, because I was really worried that jury wasn't going to find her way to Street Fighter V, considering how badly she was done in Street Fighter IV. And I do like Urien a lot. I didn't play much Urien in Third Strike, because I'm not good at Third Strike. I didn't play much Urien. But I'll tell you, I have played a decent amount of him in Street Fighter V. And I really do like him. He's really cool. But the game just is not the game I wanted. And I know that sounds really bad. I know I sound like some crazy person. But there's just a lot of things about the game that just are not what I wanted out of a new Street Fighter. And that's one of the big reasons. The other reason is that King of Fighters 13, the online is just, it's just busted. It's a mess. I hate it. I hate the way they did it. I hate the way they implemented it. I haven't played since the first patch that was supposed to fix online, and it didn't feel like it fixed it. So maybe it's better now. I haven't tried it since. I do really, really like the game. I know a lot of people had a lot of problems with the art style and everything else. I didn't. I thought that it was a really nice art style. I really liked it. But there won't be spoilers. There won't be a fighting game on the Games of the Year this year, just because I don't feel like any of them deserve it. So anyway, we're getting to the end of this video. We're showing the possible origins here of the evil Dennis character, which we think is pretty funny. We've got a lot more to come in the next few days, in the next week, and definitely in the coming weeks. So make sure to subscribe to the channel so you're made aware of all this stuff as it comes out. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, give it a like. Also, if you watched all the way to the very end here, let me know in the comments, because I really want to know. I want to know how many people watch this whole thing. You guys are troopers. Thanks a lot. And I promise the next video will not be a backlog video. So don't worry about that. And hope you guys are having a great day. Hope you're having a good holiday season. Hope you bought a lot of good stuff. Hope you're getting a lot of good gifts. And we will have content for you, both on the Hades Times YouTube channel and the Hades Times website. As always, the Hades Times website's link is in the comments of every video. In the description of every video. So you can check it out there. And I hope you guys are having a good day. See y'all later.